Thank you, Francois, very much. I'm a bit worried that as a banker, you didn't notice you'd gone into the red there by 4 minutes, but they were very interesting remarks you made anyway, and a lot of things to pick up. One thing I'd love to ask you first, actually, is you described the creation of the euro as a very risky bet. And you said we didn't know yet whether it was a winning bet or a losing bet. I just wondered when you thought we would know and how we will know. Will it be in dramatic fashion and will it be soon?
My personal view is that it can take some time and that there is a race now. This is what I think, maybe I'm wrong, but that there is a race within Europe between growth on the one side and, let's say, the fact that this is a winning or a losing bet. If we don't restore growth in all European countries, then it could be a losing bet. And there is now a race. You know, I come from a country which is basically a European country and which has very strong European convictions. But I'm really struck that in my country, the debate over, you know, let's say, the role played by Germany, the fact that a few people that are supposed to be serious are developing arguments saying that Germany is voluntarily entertaining the crisis because basically it is benefiting from the crisis. This is worrying because you would not have heard that just 2 years ago.
Yeah. Absolutely, I agree with you. It's the whole fragmentation at a political level is very concerning. You should come to the UK if you want to hear more of that anti-European sentiment. There's plenty of it around.
The UK is an island.
Exactly. Always will be. You linked in actually to one of the points I wanted to pick up with Antonia, which was you talked in your words at the beginning about the conflict or the tension between the austerity agenda and the growth agenda, but also bringing into that the financial stability agenda. And that, I suppose, is the key thing, isn't it? At what point, if I use deleveraging as a kind of proxy for financial stability, at what point does the world, in Europe in particular, need to stop deleveraging after a period of massive over-leveraging in the run-up to the crisis? At what point do we say, okay, that's enough, and we should start growing our, as banks, our balance sheets again, start lending more as consumers, we should start borrowing more?
Well, that's absolutely the fundamental question to answer, and I fully agree with what Francois said, that we should seek to have growth, but the problem that people have to understand is that the origin of the crisis was the huge imbalances in current accounts between countries, i.e. some countries borrowed too much because they were consuming more than what they produced. And the only way to fundamentally address this and therefore to allow the debts to be repaid to a reasonable level is to enhance competitiveness in these countries. So the big problem about how to restore growth is that if we lose austerity, we might fail. I.e., if we go back to reflectionary, to expansionist policies, and Portugal, Spain, Italy, Greece start consuming again without having restructured their production sectors and being competitive again, what will happen is again a widening of the current accounts. So these countries will borrow again from the north in order to consume more, and you go back to another problem which would be much bigger. So that is why austerity, which is obviously very painful, is the only right direction. what should be questioned is the intensity. Mm-hmm. And there is a difficult way to address things, and there is an easier way to address things. The difficulty is the one we are doing now, which is the South, as François says. The South has to implement austerity, but Germany, which doesn't need austerity, is not actioning expansionary policies which would increase imports from the South and therefore rebalance the southern economies as they contract their local demand. Mm. And this same question within the Eurozone is exactly the same question that happens in the world, where China should inflate their economy because they can borrow and they would import from the Western world. But given that China is not doing that, the adjustment is much more painful in the United States, in Japan, and in Europe. So that's why losing austerity is so dangerous, and that's why we have to go slowly in this adjustment, so questioning the intensity, but we cannot question the direction, because otherwise the problem would become much bigger.
Yes, please.
If I may, I tend to agree that there is a timing issue, because if I take the example of my own country, we said in 2014 we will reach a 3% target debt to GDP, deficit to public deficit to GDP ratio. Okay. A lot of people were skeptical about that, and they were right to be skeptical, because at the same time, we were not very clear about the reforms we will undertake so as to reach the target. The result is, well, from a market point of view, there is a deficit of credibility. I guess that even from a market point of view, it's easier to say or to understand that the target is, let's say, not 2014, but is, let's say, 2017 or whatever, but that the tools used to reach the target are really credible, and that the reforms necessary to reach the target on the long-term basis are credible. And I really think that if the agenda is we reach more balanced public accounts over years, but we undertake the reforms necessary to do that, then this is something which is credible for the markets, and that they will, in a way, buy that. France is a very typical example or counter example of this. Yeah. We always say we'll do it as soon as possible, but basically we never do it. So
that's what I was going to ask. I mean, is there any prospect of France engaging in greater austerity? But
I absolutely agree with you, and I defend it publicly that it was imperative for Portugal, for example, and Ireland, given the success they had, to have more years for adjusting.
Yeah.
But although I agree with your point of timing, what I think is critical is that we keep the direction. So I agree with the timing, which is intensity, but I think the direction is critical. And the only way, so the easier way, because both are difficult, but the easier way, in my opinion, to get out of this, as you say, is to action at the same time the right measures in order for the countries to become more competitive. And therefore, as you repay part of your debts, you start exporting more, you are more competitive, and both match in the future. The fear that I have, and what I have watched, is that we have weak European leadership in several countries, and those governments are not taking the necessary measures to restructure, number one, the public sector, and to decrease the heavy weight of the state, and they ask for more time, but when they have more time, they become complacent, and they don't adjust. And this is the difficult thing, in my opinion, to conciliate.
Yeah. 10 years ago, I spent 3 or 4 years living in Germany, and at that point, when I first got there in 2003, Germany was known as the sick man of Europe. Within that period, huge reforms have been put in place, and clearly Germany is now reaping the rewards of that. At what point, or to what degree, do you think France absolutely has to engage in that fundamental restructuring?
Well, as I'm not supposed to be a friend of the present government in France, given my let's say my past, I can speak very freely. As a banker, we see a lot of investors because we get financing from them. In 2009 and 2010, we had a lot of questions from investors on the Eurozone. A lot of questions. Frankly speaking, not a lot of questions of the bank, but a lot of questions on the Eurozone. Investors saying basically, good bank, bad neighborhood. Okay, well, which is a problem. But in 2011, 2012, the questions have a little bit changed, and we have now really a lot of questions on France rather than a lot of questions on the Eurozone, which for me is a signal that we are perceived as being a little bit irresolute in a way, which I think is the case. We all know that this is necessary for France to restore its public accounts. We all know that it is something we have not been doing for the past 30 years. So we all know that this is a very big change for any government in France to let's say, to change this and to be really serious in tackling these issues. So I don't know if France is the sick man of Europe. I don't think so. I think that France is now at a turning point and that it has to be more resolute in dealing with its own problems and in implementing a few reforms that are necessary in our country.
Okay, I've just got one more question that I'd like to ask both of you, and then I'm like to open the questions to the floor. Just a very quick one on the latest scare, I suppose, in the Eurozone was in Cyprus. There are two schools of thought about Cyprus. One, that it's a very small island, and what happened there was a one-off, and it's nothing to be worried about. The other school of thought says a precedent was set in Cyprus, firstly by the scary prospect that depositors would lose their money even when they were within insured deposit limits of 100,000 euros. And also, even when that initial idea was dropped, that other investors, bondholders, senior bondholders would lose money. That set another important precedent, potentially dangerous precedent. To what extent do you think the sentiment about the Eurozone has been further damaged by the way European policymakers treated the Eurozone issue? Maybe François first.
I think the most, a few comments on Cyprus. First, it's very important that at the end of the day, European governments reiterated that deposits below 100,000 euros benefit from a strong guarantee from their governments and states and from deposits systems, insurance deposit systems. This is key because the bulk of deposits in main European banks come from small deposits. This is not a story of big depositors, this is a story of people using their banks to provide them with small deposits. So this is really key. The second issue is that I think it's now urgent to define what are the rules of the game if a bank has difficulties. this is very important for investors to know what are the rules of the game, if they are to be bailed in or not, because for the time being, the rule is there is no rule. And up to Cyprus, it was just a theoretical game. Now it is a real game. So it's important to define new rules for resolution of banks in Europe.
And it's important that they should be the same across Europe.
Yes, yeah. I definitely think
so. They're predictable.
So. And it's important to have a European resolution authority, one authority, not 17 national authorities.
Yeah.
Because this authority has to be credible in all European countries. Mm-hmm. If it is not seen as credible, then banks will be seen as less credible as well. Mm-hmm. And then you are in not a virtuous circle.
Do you agree with that, Anthony?
Well, I have a slightly more pessimistic view, because I mean, trying to put myself in the shoes of the Cyprus people, people put their money in banks because they trust banks. And then banks use the money to foster economic growth and lend into the economy. Given interest rates are extremely low, to have raised the possibility of deposits losing the money, although as you say, Francois, the small deposits were protected in the end, but the fact that they were threatened, number one, and number two, the fact that deposits above 100,000 euros were cut by at least 37%, up to 60, probably, as we know, yeah. I think is a very, very bad precedent. And second, I think to impose capital controls is a disaster, because then we have 2 euros. We have 1 euro in Cyprus and all the other euros outside Cyprus, because the euro in Cyprus cannot go outside Cyprus. So I think this is, although it's a small case, no doubt, but I don't think the problem here is small or big. I think Cyprus is part of the European Union, therefore solidarity should have been bigger than just taking a technical decision. And again, I believe that the leadership of Europe failed in this process. And although I agree with you, this should be a one-off precedent, I think it's a very bad precedent. Mm. And we still have capital controls in Cyprus, which I don't see how they will be taken out, because everybody then will put the money somewhere else.
Absolutely.
So I think there is a serious risk of money flowing out from banks in weak countries into, as I said in my speech, into Switzerland, into Northern Europe, and into the United Kingdom. Interest rates are the same. Why should I have the money where I think there might be a problem? So this is a serious issue, and I fully agree with Francois that this should be tackled as soon as possible and have clear rules as soon as possible, a single resolution authority, a single guarantee fund, and therefore banking union.
Yes.
But this is going to take time, so I'm quite worried about this precedent.
And I know we went off at a bit of a tangent there on Cyprus, but I think it is crucial really to the future growth of the Eurozone that you don't have that kind of fragmentation clearly. I'd love to open it up to the floor if I suspect people may have questions. I can see some hands raised. I think there are microphones making their way around. If I could go to the gentleman at the back, yeah, please, first.
Hello, my name is Rodrigo. I'm a student from Nova University. My question is for Monsieur Perol, but Mr. Horta Osorio can also give his opinion. Was it a good bet to launch the common currency project without setting up at the same time the proper structures to allow the countries to maintain a regulated and balanced dialogue on common budgetary and investment policies, like giving a more important role to the European Parliament?
So Francois, basically picking up your point that to create the euro on its own without any other sense of collaboration and integrity at a Eurozone level in terms of budgetary fiscal responsibilities, was that a mistake?
I said it was a bet. I don't know if it was a mistake. We don't know yet. But it was surely a bet. I'm not sure that the people at that time were really sad that it was a bet. But you may remember that a few economists in 1999 said, well, the Europeans are taking a risk because they are, as we say in French, on met la charrue avant les bœufs, as we said in French.
We say this here as well.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. And in English.
that is to say, we are creating the common currency, but we don't have, at the same time, the tools that go with the common currency. Milton Friedman, for instance, said so. He said in a study published in the 90s that it could succeed, but it could not as well. So what we have to do now, but it takes a lot of time to do that usually. If you look, for instance, at the example of the United States of America, it takes a lot of time to build a federal debt, to build a federal budget, to build a federal a common policy. So I'm, in a way, you know, I'm optimistic because I really think it is necessary for Europe to stay united and integrated economic zone. This is one of our best possible way to succeed in globalization. I'm optimistic, but let's say we don't know if it is a mistake. We don't know yet. Yeah. Maybe it was. I hope it was not.
Antonio, so it was a necessary first step, but you couldn't have gone further at the time.
I don't know if it was necessary. It was a bet.
Yeah.
But it was not said to the people at that time that it was a bet.
No.
That's right.
It was said that this was the right way to build Europe. It was a risky way, let's put it this way. It was a risky way. Yeah. And now we are on this bumpy and risky road. So,
would there
let's
a
move forward. This is the only way we have to.
Well, would there have been a better way?
I fully agree with you. I mean, I think, as you said in your speech, we cannot forget that the genesis of the European project is a political project with the aim of not ever again having war in Europe. And that was the reason why the European Union was set up in the beginning. It is obviously theoretical at university. It's much easier to set up everything perfect and then you put it on. But in reality, you have to take the people with you. It is a democratic process. And you go by deepening the Union according to the results that you see. And therefore, I think it was the right thing to do. I think at this point in time, we really need leadership in Europe to take the difficult decisions. And the difficult decisions are about solidarity versus the national interests. I mean, for the European Union project to continue, we have to want to be Europeans. My feeling is that the support for the European project is going down, especially in the peripheric countries, because people see the austerity and they don't see the light and they see, why are we doing this? So I think this is very dangerous, because if the politicians don't come quicker with a solution, then they may lose the public support in order to do the right thing. And I am, like you, absolutely Europeist, so I think we should be Europeans. Europe together is much stronger than every country individually, and therefore it would be a pity that the project failed.
Can I invite one more question? Yes, please.
To Antonio, you mentioned...
Yeah, if you could just introduce yourself.
I'm
quickly,
Felipe, sir. I'm CFO of a large Portuguese company.
Thank you.
Antonio mentioned the English economist Ricardo. Ricardo's whole thesis was that each country should focus on what it does best, and actually his conclusion was that Portugal, which was his example, should focus on wine making, and UK should focus on textiles. Sounds like a good deal to me. The point is, a country like Portugal or Greece is having huge competitive disadvantages today. And it goes to the point of fragmentation. A bank like François's bank in Euroland should not be thinking, when it extends a loan to Greece or Portugal, whether there is a currency risk to it. It should look at the intrinsic credit risk of the counterparty. A New York bank lending to a Mississippi company does not factor in a 300 basis point margin for the risk of Mississippi exiting the dollar. So we have enough problems in the periphery. Shouldn't the ECB do whatever it takes, meaning underwriting exit risk to the financial system? Should not the ECB guarantee to all lenders to the periphery that if there is an exit risk, it is underwritten by the ECB?
More explicit.
I honestly don't agree. I honestly don't agree because I think the ECB has a clear mandate. The mandate is a mandate about monetary policy. And the ECB should not go into the moral hazard of guaranteeing the debt of the countries. And then if the countries, because you are assuming the countries will not exit the euro, will not become bankrupt. If a country becomes bankrupt, then the ECB may have a systemic problem and the ECB would lose all credibility, which I think would be much, much worse for Europe. So what do I think is the solution? First, I think that Ricardo had said something which was fantastic, which was each one should specialize, as you say, where each one is best. But he said, even if the UK is better than Portugal in everything, it makes sense for both to specialize. So it's the law of the relative comparative advantages. And so there is always something where Portugal should specialize because it will be relatively better at that, and therefore trade makes sense. Relating to the point that is the key point of your question, which is, okay, but how are we going to turn around this advantage, this disadvantage of the Portuguese companies having a premium for the currency risk? Well, there are many other disadvantages in different countries, and I think the only way, as François was also saying in his speech, is that we go towards a banking union. If we go towards a banking union with a common supervisor and a common guarantee fund, people will feel that the banks in each country are safe because there is a common guarantee fund and supervision and criteria behind, and the risk premium should go down because you dissociate the risk between the banks and the risk between the countries. So even if a bank is going to lend to a company in a risky country, you would have, like in Mississippi, the risk of the company in Mississippi, but the bank itself would have a different rating from the rating of the country. So the separation from banks ratings in Portugal, Spain, Italy, and Greece from the country can only be done based on banking union. And that's where I think we should head.
François, would you like to add?
I tend to agree that this is key to lower the risk premium, which is now on bear by companies in a few European countries, especially in Portugal, in Spain, not to mention Greece, of course, but in Italy as well. It is key to do that because my feeling is, when I look at the operations we have in these countries, it's more and more difficult for companies to get financing, especially when these companies are small and medium-sized companies, because the price is too high and the banks are no longer lending. And it has nothing to do with more VLTRO or whatever. It has to do with the risk premium which is put on these companies. So how to reduce that is really key. The banking union is part of the solution. The issue is how long does this take? Yeah. And I guess the ECB will have to take some additional action before that so as to reduce the risk premium on these countries and so as to make it possible for the SMEs in these countries to get financing from the banks again, because if it does not happen soon, then the issue is the following. Economic growth will, unemployment will go on rising, economic growth will go on being down, and non-performing loans in balance sheet of banks will increase, and it will be more and more difficult for these, for national banks in this country to get financing. Yeah. Just to give you an example, we, as a bank, we decided not to, we don't buy any sovereign debt or any debt from banks coming from periphery countries. Yeah. Why that? The reason for that is the following. If we do it, we have to disclose it.
Exactly.
If we disclose it to the market, then the reaction from investors will be, what you guys are doing, you are taking risks which are not reasonable. So what do we do? Basically, we lend to these countries, but no longer than 3 months. Why that? Because we publish accounts on a 3 months basis, okay? So at the end of each 3 months period, my balance sheet is free from any risk from the periphery countries. And it's not exactly the case during this each 3 months period. But what they need is not 3 months money. What they need is longer money. And I'm totally unable, even if I have excess cash, to lend this money. And what do I do with my excess cash? I put it at the central bank at 0%. And why is that? Because investors are happy if I show them huge liquidity reserves and huge amounts of cash. So this is what I do. And what is the reason why I do that? Because I lose money. The reason why I do that is I need money from investors. For financing the bulk of my business, I need money from these investors. So if we don't break this really vicious circle between the lack of confidence which is still there within the market, then fragmentation will go on, and the difficulties in a few countries will increase. So this is key. Banking union is key. Resolution authority is key, and one resolution authority, not 17. Mm. Because if we have 17, then, well, okay, nothing is really changed. This is how things are going. All banks, all banks in Europe, I think so, have been asked by their supervisors to study the breakup of the Eurozone and to build their operations so as to reduce their own risk in case there is a breakup of the Eurozone. So we try to fund our operations in each country with money from these countries, which is exactly the contrary of the objectives of creating a common currency. So I share Antonio's view, but I strongly think that at the same time, on the short-term basis, the ECB needs to take additional actions in order to help financing SMEs in so-called peripheral countries.
I would agree with you. I think you're absolutely right, and the ECB could take, for example, securitization of SME loans or other loans, but it would have to have the proper haircuts to avoid going into fiscal policy. But securitization of SME loans or mortgage-backed securities, that would help rebalancing the flows into the countries where the money is going out from. So
I'm awfully sorry, but there are messages for me.
There are.
The first message was, it's time to go.
That's about 20
minutes ago.
And now
the message is, you won't catch your flight.
Now it says there is a football match. That will complicate the traffic.
It's best to leave now.
Yes.
So I think I will be fine out in a few minutes.
Good luck.
So I'm really sorry.
Thank you, François. You've been a tremendous asset.
I guess I have to leave. Thank you very much. Thank you, Antonio.
Very good to see you. Please speak.
Thank you very much. Let me see.
Thank you again, François. We'll hope that you make your flight, and but we'll carry on. I think we've got about 10 minutes left with Antonio. And I'm sure there's some more questions from the floor. So if I can ask you to raise your hand. Yes, at the back. Thank you. If you can introduce yourself again.
Boa tarde. Meu nome é Andreia, sou estudante do ISCTE. A minha pergunta era dirigida mais especialmente ao Sr. François Perrault, mas não foi embora, portanto. Mas na sua intervenção inicial, ele referiu que os problemas para a desintegração da União Europeia poderiam vir especialmente de um ponto de vista político. E que, de um ponto de vista económico, não era do interesse de nenhum país da União Europeia, nem mesmo da Alemanha, essa desintegração. E a minha pergunta era se países como Portugal, a Grécia, mesmo a Espanha, etc., em vez de se associarem, como tem sido a norma, aos interesses alemães, poderiam utilizar esse interesse alemão de um ponto de vista económico, da União Europeia não se desintegrar, juntando-se para defender os seus próprios interesses, ou se os riscos políticos seriam maiores que esse interesse económico que a Alemanha tem ainda em manter a União Europeia.
Certo. You don't mind I answer in Portuguese?
Please do.
Andreia, eu obviamente, o François já não está aqui, portanto não sei exatamente o que é que ele pretendia dizer com isso. Mas eu não me custa nada a conceber que, teoricamente, nenhum país tenha incentivos para deixar o euro e deixar a União Europeia. Mas também lhe diria com franqueza que, uma vez que é estudante de economia, sabe como é que são as teorias económicas, não é? Primeiro, assumimos que o mundo tem informação perfeita. Segundo, assumimos que não há custos de transação. E terceiro, assumimos que as pessoas são racionais. E, portanto, com essas premissas é muito fácil fazer modelos. Ou seja, eu penso que, apesar de ser correto de que, racionalmente falando, Portugal não tem nenhum incentivo para deixar a União Europeia, nem a Alemanha tem, porque a Alemanha exporta enormemente para os países do sul da Europa a uma moeda, que é o euro, que está subavaliada em relação àquilo que o Deutsche Mark estaria caso não fosse o euro. Portanto, a Alemanha tem um enorme interesse, dado o enorme mercado que se abriu, não só na Europa, mas fora da Europa, porque o Deutsche Mark estaria muito mais caro se não estivesse inserido no euro, porque o escudo, a peseta, a lira puxam-no para baixo. Portanto, não há dúvida nenhuma que, racionalmente, os países não têm interesse em deixar, por essas razões, a União Europeia. Portugal também não tem, porque perdia imediatamente acesso a fundos europeus, perdia acesso a um mercado muito maior. Mas as pessoas não são inteiramente racionais. E aquilo que eu receio é que o impacto da austeridade, que tem um impacto muito real na vida concreta das pessoas, leve, como dizia há bocadinho na minha intervenção, leve os governos a perderem apoio popular para fazer o que é correto e que as pessoas possam resolver, como por exemplo a Itália, onde tem um partido com 25% dos votos que surgiu do zero e que é completamente contra a permanência no euro e na União Europeia, pode acontecer que de repente haja um erro porque as pessoas emocionalmente não estão dispostas a seguir no caminho que acham que não tem saída.
Thank you. I liked the German bit at the beginning. I got that. Alemania. Anyway, I think we've got time for one more question. I'm sorry to have to cut people short. Over on the right-hand side, yes, the Maybe lady two. There.
Thank Maybe you, two. Patricia Denhardt, Lucia de University. Thank you very much for a very thoughtful speech. And to pick up on your point that austerity is the right direction, but that maybe the intensity of the austerity is what should be changed, my question would be, from your perspective as a banker, what would it take to convince Germany, which I gather is the main actor which would have to change its policy in that sense, what would it take Germany to accept a change in the intensity yeah. of the austerity measures, yeah. given that we've got now 5 months of electoral campaign in Germany? Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's exactly the $1 million question, as I said in the beginning. Theoretically, if you make an economist model, the answer is very easy. You put China expanding fiscal policy and importing from the rest of the world, and you make Germany increasing fiscal policy. Germany now has, as you know, a fully balanced budget. So Germany is the only country of the big countries in Europe that does not have a deficit. You make Germany expand fiscal policy, you ask the Germans to spend more, and you solve the problem of Southern Europe. The problem is, it's a small economist problem, is that the Germans do not want to spend more, they want to save. And given they don't want to spend more, they want to save, they don't export, they don't import more from Southern Europe. So this is an absolute dilemma, the same with the Chinese versus the US, Europe, and Japan. And given that you cannot export to Mars, you have to export to somewhere, you have this dilemma. So it would be fantastic if Brazil, India, China, and Germany change their culture and said, we are going to spend more because we can. We have said for decades, now we can spend more. And while the UK, the US, Italy, Portugal, Spain are adjusting, the adjustment would be much easier because as you would be contracting demand locally, you'd be exporting to demand outside of your country. But things do not work like that.
That would be the perfect economic solution. Yeah. What about, just to pick up on the question, is there any hope of a more political solution in the sense that I think part of the question was around the extent to which Germany might be persuadable to moderate its the strictness of its demands? Probably not until an election is out of the way, but post-election?
I don't want to go too much into politics, which is not my expertise. But I would tell you that I see it very difficult that the European project can succeed without a more balanced approach between austerity locally in the countries which are more fragile and more solidarity from the countries which are in a stronger position, i.e., to be very blunt, I see it very difficult without more transfers from the north into the south, like you have in the United States, between rich zones and weaker zones. I think solidarity and austerity will have to be better balanced, and that is the genesis, I believe, and I repeat, of the European project.
Well, let us hope that the politics of Europe can allow that economic solution to happen. I don't see any great hope for this year, I have to say,
maybe depending on the result, Mrs. Merkel will be more forthcoming.
Everyone's got their hopes pinned on 2014, I think. So on that vaguely optimistic note, I'd like to thank Antonio and Francois in his absence for their participation. And thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Great. Okay.